Hello friends, welcome back. In this session, we are going to talk more about in-depth details of pipeline. I have introduced you to the pipelining concepts, the pipelining registers, the hazards in pipelining, the fundamental concepts of the forwarding, bypassing, everything I have covered. But this session is going to go deeper into the data hazards and the forwarding related concepts. So it requires some sort of attention, and also I would be okay if you have a paper and pen with you to try out some concepts which I'm going to teach right now in this session. I require sincere attention because some concepts are tricky. So if you follow it carefully, it is going to be easy for you. Now let's see the instruction sequence here. That's the scenario that we need to understand right now. Sub $2, $1, $3 and $12, $2, $5. You can see that the first instruction is subtract, which is going to get the result stored in $2, and the second instruction is going to be AND, which is going to use this result as part of the operands. Third instruction is also using this $2. The fourth instruction is also using the $2. The fifth instruction is also using the $2. So what I suggest to you is $2 is the result that we get out of the first instruction, which is going to be part of all other instructions, which is going to be a problem. The first operand of AND is dependent on sub. The second operand of OR is dependent on sub. The add, the first and second operands, both are dependent on sub. The store word, the index is dependent on the sub. Now, the question is very simple. The result of the first operand will be available, first instruction will be available after say about certain clock cycles. But this instruction in pipelining would have started by then. So do we have the correct result for the second instruction to proceed? Do we have the correct result for the third, fourth and fifth instructions to proceed in the pipeline? The pipeline may not provide you with the appropriate result at the time that you want is the point. Now I'll repeat it this way. The first instruction subtract is going to have the result in the $2 register as 10. 10 is the initial value, but after the subtraction operation, it will become 5. Now it will remain 10 for certain clock cycles. It will be updated to appropriate result as 5 after some amount of clock cycles, which means the real result that you want would not be available immediately and would need time to do that. So the pipelining would suffer a problem with this data, which is not the updated and the correct one. So what will happen is very simple. Whatever data is available there already might be sent to the rest of the instructions to process it, which is not correct. So I need the correct data for me to proceed is the point. The programming logic would also be written in such a way that you getting correct answer only be respected. You will not, or you would not have considered the point that the data which is not updated would be sent to the further processing. I repeat, first instruction will give you the result after certain amount of time, but because of the pipelining, the next instruction would already start executing. It will not get the correct value. It may have the older value retained, or it could be a wrong value, whatever you would not expect to process. This is the problem that I am talking about. I hope I made it clear. Now we will have a visualization very clearly done here. Say that $2 has got some value 10. In the clock cycle 1, you can see that it is 10. Clock cycle 2, it is 10. Clock cycle 3, it is 10. Clock cycle 4, it is 10. At the midway of clock cycle 5 only, I have got the value correctly updated through the write back into the register, and the result that I wanted is minus 20 and is available here. Now the change happens exactly here in clock cycle 5, and up till clock cycle 4, I still retain the value of 10 in the $2. This is the problem. Now how do we solve it? Is this an issue? Yes, we need to talk about it, and that's what this session is all about. Let's ask a simple question now. The updated value is not available to us right now in front of us until clock cycle 5. This is very straightforward understanding that I have established right now. But before that, I'll ask you some question which needs to be answered properly. Can we write and read into the particular register at the same point of time? Can we write into a register and then can we read from it the same cycle? Is it possible? Now, please recollect whatever I have told you sometime back. The write will happen in the first half of the clock cycle, which means the write happens to the left, and then the read will happen in the right half of the cycle, which means the read happens in the right. Write happens to the left and then read happens to the write. You need to write to read, and you do not forget it. This is a very, very important point that we have been telling right from the beginning. This notation is important. The write happens to the left because it is the first half of the clause cycle. The read happens in the right because it is the second half of the cycle. This approach has minimized or reduced most of the hazards. The $1 million question is answered here. And now let's get back to the same problem that we faced some time back. Now what will happen? The correct result is available in clock cycle 5. So will it be available for the second instruction by the time it is needed? The second instruction needs the value exactly at CC4, which means that it won't be having it because the ALU needs the correct value. So it won't have it. The third instruction needs it exactly at the time of CC5. Could be a problem because only in the second half of it I get the value updated and I cannot have the value. So you can see that the previous value will only come and it travels in the backward direction. But the fourth instruction and the fifth instruction, if you see, they are comfortable because they get the value written and I have no problem with fourth and fifth. Now, please understand the point. I have a point here which says that the first three instructions are extremely dependent to each other, whereas the fourth and fifth instruction, there is no hazard because the value is available. I have the value for $2 available very clearly only at the end of the fifth, only at the midway of the, I mean only at the second half of the fifth cycle, which will not be sufficient for me to proceed with this and or, which means the second and third instruction cannot proceed right now and it will still have the older value 10, which is not correct. But the fourth and fifth instruction, well, we do not have a problem. Now, how do we solve it? Well, we have a very important scenario to be understood. That's going to be a notation that we are going to follow. Now, how do we handle if the values are available appropriately? We can forward and there is no special effort required there. We'll simply forward it. And what do we do normally? We say that we will take the value from the, what do we say normally? We will say that we will forward the result from the third stage and then we can forward it here. So this is what we normally say. We can forward it is what, or we can bypass it as we say, and that's fine. Forward the data as soon as it is available is the solution that we all will be saying. But we have something else that we need to know. Because of this notations, whatever we are drawing, because of this diagrammatic representation only, we have so many problems related to how do we represent this. I say it again, the functionality is all fine. We have solutions for it. I am talking about the representation of the pipelining system. And you see that here, this representation only creates problems. So do we have some sort of rules that can clearly convey that there is a dependency of this to this? Yes, there are four rules available, 1A, 1B, 2A, 2B. You will have to probably memorize it because I don't find any other way to probably get it clearly by the time you understand things. EX/mem.registerd rd = id/exrs EX/mem register rd = id/exrt. Similarly, mem/wbrd, here it is rs. mem/wbrd, here it is rt. So these four rules are framed as 1a 1b 2a 2b. Just remember this notation. These are called hazard conditions. Please remember, this is called hazard conditions. Now, how is it actually working? So what is it, sir? ID/EX is the name of the pipelining register. The dot after which will represent there is a register which is going to come in the next half of it. So this is a combination of a pipeline register, followed by a register which has some connect to it. What is the connector? I'll explain you that clearly. The value which is mentioned in the right hand side needs the value which is available in the register, which is here. What I mean is very simple. This is the register that requests the value that is available here. RS is the register that requests the value which is available in ID/EX. Please remember that. This is how we have the notation. Now, there could be questions which can ask you to check what are the hazard conditions which are prevailing in the given sequence. So, we'll take the same sequence of sub and. Here it is sub, first instruction. $2, $1, $3. The result will be available in $2. Second instruction is AND $12, $2, $5. So this $2 will be updated only when this instruction is done. Now there is a hazard. This hazard has to be represented as 1A, 1B, 2A or 2B very clearly. Now how do we represent it, sir? Very simple. Whatever this guy needs, RD needs, is available in EX/mem. This is what I have been telling you for a past few minutes. Now, how do we sort it out, sir? Very simple. You see that The second instructions RD is $2. Second instructions, the first instructions RD, EX slash mem, you can see that, which is EX slash mem. This is the EX slash mem register. This has got the content which is needed by RD, and that has to be sent to ID slash EX. This is nothing but the second stage, the ID slash EX. Okay, ID slash EX source, that's it. This second instruction source is being fed by first instruction's result, and that's what is very clearly mentioned here. EX mem of RD, which means that here is the result available anyways for me. EX mem, I have a pipelining register available in between. You know the pipelining formats, right? I have clearly explained that in the previous sessions. You can see that this is the EX mem. This EX mem is the one that has the result. Okay, EX mem is the one that has the result. Now let's come back here. You will understand that clearly now. EX mem is the one that has the result which should be updated to RD. And then I need the same thing in the RS of the second instruction, which should be sent through ID slash EX. So it should be available here for me to feed in. So it belongs to class 1A. This is the way you need to classify it. This hazard classification is very, very important, and you may get questions which are related to any of these kind of sequence which will ask you to classify which hazard it is. Now again, please remember the points very clearly. You need to identify and understand what are these classifications of the hazard. You need to remember the sequence carefully, and why this format comes is very carefully to be understood. Otherwise, it may not be easy for you to handle it in the exam. And the value which the second half is needing is available in the first register. That's the notation that we need to have. I'll quickly go through one example. The same question, whatever we have had. The first rule we have classified. Is there a hazard in the first and the third instruction? Sub and R. Do we have a hazard? I have the result available here in $2, and I use that in $1. So I need this in the source, which means IDEX is needing it. RT is the one that is available here. This is the RT. RSRT is here. RT is the one that I need. So this part is very clear. ID slash EX dot register RT. This is what I need. But where is it available from? It is available in $2, which is nothing but RD, the destination register. But when it would be available? It would be available in mem, and you can see that clearly. Mem WB is the stage where it is available. This is the stage where it will be available. You can see that. Now let us draw the picture and understand it. The data which is available here has to be sent here. You can see the blue line highlighted here clearly. The data which is available here has to be sent here. This is how we need to realize and understand. Rest all, I do not have any hazard in this, and that can be handled through forwarding and simply done. So it's easy. So I hope I made it clear. We'll come back to you with more content and more topics in the next session. Thank you very much for following my channel and the content. Please go through this the second time for you to understand it better. If at all you cannot understand it the first time, thank you very much.